I'm sorry that we've started a bit late. Politicians are busy people, so we have to make allowances, I think, for that. As you might know, there's been a huge interest in this event, and we sold out the first venue of 250 within a couple of hours, and then booked this venue for 1,000 people, and many more watching us live as we go. So this is really a moment where people need to come together to talk about where we go from here. And having said that, I really just want to welcome and express solidarity with everyone here, with everyone watching, with everyone in the country who has experienced xenophobic or racist abuse in the last weeks. I know that sort of racism and xenophobia was not invented with a referendum, but it has certainly given space and legitimacy to a lot of quite horrible and angry expression over the last weeks especially. And so with that, I really just want to especially welcome those people to the space, and people who don't always feel particularly comfortable in this kind of setting and this kind of political way of doing things. So just to say, we recognize that, and you're very welcome here. And just one more thing, this is not an easy conversation, and we aren't going to agree with each other. The panel won't always agree with each other, and I'm sure many of you will disagree with each other and with what is said here. And so can I ask that we just show each other compassion and respect in how we engage with each other this evening, whether that's live here, whether it's on the comments and Facebook or on the live stream. So now for the agenda, what we're going to do is we're going to kick off with who's the chair of Compass, and who's going to say a few words about our organisation, what we're doing, and about why we're here tonight. And then we're going to open up to the panel. We've got a great group of panellists here tonight. We're still waiting for Clive Lewis, Vince Cable and Tommy Shepherd, who will be joining us at different stages throughout the evening. We will also have space for contributions from the floor, so don't worry about that. And I do ask you to please tweet. There's a Progressive Alliance hashtag that you can use, so stay engaged with the conversation. And there's also a poll on Facebook. If you were on the Facebook event, there's a poll to engage with different questions that are being asked throughout the evening. I have the question somewhere, but I can't find it now, so I'll read it to you later. So with that, can I ask you to welcome Neil Lawson to the stage?
Hi. Thank you, Jackie. It's been a few days and weeks of shock. Brexit, leadership crisis, the potential breakup of the UK, the potential breakup of Europe, and then the biggest shock of all, realising that you're actually older than Nigel Farage. Look, Brexit's a wake-up call for the left. If we don't wake up now, when will we? Compass woke up some time ago, I think. We knew that a progressive alliance was necessary, not just a single big tent, but a campsite where the sun was greater than the parts, a campsite where we could all flourish. But I think it's now going to be more than just a defensive move, more than just a thing that recognises the threat of the right, both a rejuvenated Conservative Party and a reformed, morphed UKIP party. It has to be a progressive alliance about the future, that owns the concept of hope, that owns the concept of love, that is an alliance of both hearts and minds. Not just a politics of pacts and deals, but an end to despair, an end to humiliation, an end to loneliness, and an alliance for love, compassion, for a politics of real imagination, real joy, a world in which we can all flourish. Brexit pulled the pin on the old politics and welcomes in the new politics. Look, there's no going back. Things in politics will never, ever be the same. It's a different terrain. And you know what you need on new terrain? You need a compass. No one likes a smart ass, but we've been saying this stuff for quite a long time, right? So if you can and if you want to, join us, help us, so that we can help you. And I just want to say thank you to Jackie for tonight, thank you to Aisha, to Claire and all of the volunteers for making tonight happen so quickly and so well. Please join me in thanking them. And I tell you about the three of them. They didn't wait for something to happen. They didn't wait for someone else. They moved themselves and make this event happen. None of us must wait anymore. We are the people that we've been waiting for. This is our time. It's the time of the Democrats, of the pluralists, of the people who believe the best in our fellow human beings, not the worst. The people who are guided by hope and not fear. The optimists, the sustainers, the carers, the innovators, the builders, the architects, the egalitarians, the craftspeople, the nurturers. This is our time and this is our place. I don't think we're ever going to build the good society in the 20th century, a century of hierarchies, of top-down, of command and control. But in the 21st century, in a world of flatter structures, in a world of horizontalism, in a world of networks, we can usher in the politics that is really democratic and really egalitarian. Our task, not just to make politics a tiny bit better, it's not the better caterpillar we want. It's the butterfly that we're after. The butterfly of a new politics. A butterfly of hope that we can create societies, communities, a country, a Europe, a globe that fulfills our dreams, that fulfills our wishes, just as the right did with their dreams and their wishes. But ours are better. We are right. This is our time. This is our place. Let's make it happen. Enjoy this evening. And let's build a progressive alliance for a progressive politics in Britain. Thank you, Jackie.
Thank you very much, Neil. I realise I forgot to introduce myself. I'm Jackie Howard from Compass. So just on that Facebook poll, the first question is, do you support the idea of a progressive alliance of parties, movements and citizens to contest the next general election? That's on the post-Brexit event page, and everyone can sort of engage in the poll live. So do go and do that if you feel like it. So we're going to go on now with the panel. I will say thank you when you have reached your time. So we're going to start with Caroline Lucas MP from the Green Party.
You're not going to agree with me now, and you'll boo me when I start talking, so I might quit while I'm ahead and go and sit down. But seriously, it is wonderful to be among all of you tonight, and such a hopeful sign that so many of you have come out at such short notice to be here with us. And friends, I believe that our democracy is broken. How else to explain the depth of the divisions which scar our country, and which were revealed in all their visceral rawness by this bleak and bitter referendum result? A campaign that has shown as well that the divisions within parties are as large as the divisions between them. And that's why I believe that if we are to heal both our country and our democracy, then we urgently need to build a progressive alliance for electoral reform. So I've got 5 minutes and I'll make five very short points. And my first one is that the depth of the anger and alienation that was felt by so many who voted Leave must be urgently addressed. I think for many it was a howl of rage against exclusion and a sense of powerlessness. And we have to listen to that and respond. Now, in my heart, of course, I believe Britain's future should be in Europe. And the message of the petition for a second referendum that now has over 4 million signatures is an understandable cry of pain. But friends, I believe that to seek to overrule the outcome of the referendum is bad politics and worse democracy. What better way to reinforce the belief that the metropolitan elites care nothing for the views of predominantly working class people in disconnected communities than to seek to ignore their views and overturn the result? So instead, one of the priorities must be to ensure that their voices are heard, not just at the referendum, but year round. And a crucial way of doing that is to crack open the current political system that encourages the main parties to listen almost exclusively to the swing voters in marginal constituencies and to care very little for the views of everyone else. And so my second point is this, that if we are to set about healing the deep divisions in our society, which this referendum has laid bare, then we need to urgently build a more representative, inclusive democracy, and that can only be brought about by electoral reform. And friends, it is urgent. If ever I need reminding of just how high the stakes are, then I need only to speak with my constituents who are struggling to pay the rent. The services they rely on are vanishing. They're staring down the barrel at a crumbling economy, endemic low pay, and the prospect of years more austerity. The Tories are readying themselves now for another round of disaster capitalism, using the post-Brexit turmoil to further shape the economy in their interests. I believe we need to prepare for that and lobby for an early general election, because no politician has a mandate. No politician has a mandate right now to design a specific Brexit negotiation stance and to prevent the formulation of a Tory UKIP government that would enact an ultra-right Brexit scenario. I believe that there should be a pre-election pact between Labour, Greens, Lib Dems and Plaid, and that the glue holding together such a pact would indeed be a commitment to proportional representation. Now, last week, the Green Party wrote to the other party leaders with precisely that proposal, and conversations are beginning to happen. But we need to get a move on. The clock is ticking, the climate is burning, and the gap between rich and poor continues to grow ever wider. But third, my point about this progressive alliance is that it has to be more than a group of losers. This isn't just about political expedience, this is about inspiring people. Yes, I do think it's true that with the triumph of the SNP in Scotland and with constituency boundary changes coming down the line, I do think it's true that a Labour Party, no matter who its new leader might be, or if it has the same leader, no matter who its leader is, they are not likely to form a majority government at the next election. But you know, even if Labour could win an outright majority, I would still be challenging them to change the way they do politics, because I fundamentally believe that political pluralism delivers better results, that no single party has a monopoly on wisdom. And I believe that speaking to different constituencies about a shared agenda of social, environmental, and democratic reform, united in a commitment to create a fairer, more sustainable Britain, to rebuild our democracy and safeguard our public sector, I believe that would have an attractive force and political reach which no one party alone could have today. And if people like Ken Clark and Ian Duncan Smith can coexist in the same party, then for Labour, Lib Dems and Green to be fighting each other creates at best an uneven playing field and at worst is political suicide. We have to be smarter about the way we do politics. Our current two-party system dramatically underrepresents the smaller parties. And the effect on that, in terms of our political debate, is to shrink a conversation when there is a growing clamour to expand it. In an era where people have a choice of at least half a dozen realistic parties, we either seek consensus across party lines where there is broad philosophical agreement, or we ignore the views of many committed citizens, and as a result, frankly, face the prospect, the chilling prospect, of a Tory or UKIP rule for a generation and more, with all of the social and environmental destruction that that would bring. Friends, there is nothing inevitable about social progress as the rise of the right across Europe grimly demonstrates. We need to fight for a progressive future, we need to fight for it together, and that is what tonight is about. So let me tell you about how we might do it. Well, I'll tell you how we don't do it. We don't do it by stitching up agreements behind closed doors. It has to be about an open, inclusive, bottom-up process involving as many people as possible in each local area. So one proposal might be to hold open primaries to elect the best progressive candidate, either in each constituency or just in the marginals where an electoral alliance could make most impact. And that could provide, I think, an unprecedented democratic legitimacy and harness a wave of grassroots excitement and energy. It would have the potential to reach out to many who are turned off by the tribal politics of business as usual, and particularly to speak to young people, many of whom feel so bruised by this whole referendum process. And there are plenty of other scenarios that we can imagine, from individual parties, candidates signing up to a core set of progressive principles, perhaps being championed by a third-party movement, or indeed to less formal non-aggression pacts. But the bottom line is that it needs to empower individuals, not party elites, and that it better reflects the diversity of opinion that is at the heart of modern Britain. And so in my final few words, let me simply say this, that if any of this is to happen, there will need to be a change of thinking. There is no point people talking about a realignment in politics if there is not first a deeper realignment of minds. The referendum was a wake-up call. Let's honour it by rejecting xenophobia. Let's rise to it by pledging to share the economic benefits of migration more fairly. Let's respond to it by working to deliver real power to the people with a voting system that enables their voices genuinely to be heard. Now is not the time for a narrative that says you're either for us or against us. Now is the time for action and not just talking. So I hope tonight that we might get a firm commitment from Clive and Vince to do all they can to get their party leaders on board. And I want to call on each and every one of you here to play your part too. If you're a member of a political party, then tell your party leader you want to harness the power of working together. Tell your friends and families the same thing. Commit to being a groundswell that makes this happen, and to talking to everybody in the community about that, not just those who supported the Remain vote. It won't have escaped your notice that at Westminster right now, we are gripped by leadership battles. And I think that we need to remember this about leadership, that true leaders don't create followers, they create more leaders. They show the way and they lead by example. That's what we're here to do tonight. And if we succeed, it will be truly remarkable. And friends, it will change everything. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Caroline Lucas. We're going to move on and welcome Clive Lewis from the Labour Party and the Shadow Defence Minister.
Sorry for my late arrival. There's been a few things going on in the Labour Party recently. I also need to stress that I'm speaking in a very personal capacity. And Caroline did just mention then about she hopes that I would be able to speak to the leader of the Labour Party. Clearly, it's not just up to the leader of the Labour Party, it's up to the party membership itself and for people in the PLP and beyond, the affiliates, the trade unions, to begin to grip the issue that we're all here to discuss tonight. I'd like to say a few words tonight about the Labour Party and how I hope we can contribute kind of movement and progressive alliance that I think we're all here to talk about tonight. I'll be quite frank, the Labour Party is in a genuine existential crisis. And that means we all of us today in an existential crisis. I say that not with any sense of tribal superiority, just simply the idea that any kind of progressive government in this country can't be formed in Britain without the Labour Party playing a key role. It just isn't possible. As I hope is obvious, I have made the decision to stand by Jeremy Corbyn. Now, it would be easy in front of an audience like this one to spend a few minutes basking in some popularity for doing that. and after the last week or so, I would quite enjoy it. But I don't want to spend my time here justifying that choice and rubbishing those in the PLP who have publicly opposed Jeremy's leadership. There's been quite enough of that already, and whatever happens within the PLP over the coming weeks, the great majority of us are going to have to work together again, whatever format that takes. Right now, least said, soonest mended. But I do want to speak a bit about how I think we got where we are today and what that journey might mean for the future. So let's begin with the bad news. The current crisis within the Parliamentary Labour Party is not some silly ego-led squabble between wannabe leaders. It is the expression of a much deeper crisis within the Labour Party and its relationship with its voters. Nor is it a question of repositioning the Labour Party on a simplistic left-right axis. You know, we need to move to the right, or we need to move to the centre. And just in case you think I'm being partisan here, no, it isn't just a question of we need to move to the left either. The fact is that if we think like that, whichever way we move now, we are going to alienate some key parts of our potential electorate. In May 2015, we lost votes to the SNP, to UKIP, and to the Greens, three parties with wildly varying positions on the left-right axis. We failed to win over Tory Labour swing voters. We failed to get anywhere near enough Lib Dems who should have been flocking to us. Where's Vince Cable, is he? This means the Labour Party is fighting for its survival on several different flanks at once. Politically, that's a very dangerous place to be. And now we have this referendum result, which confirms what May 2015 told us about where many working class voters are going. They feel abandoned by the Labour Party, and now they, in their turn, have abandoned the Labour Party in growing numbers. I know many people in this room will have been shocked by the referendum, and many are still feeling frightened and angry about it. I campaigned, I hope, as hard as anyone for a progressive vision for remaining in, together with other people here today like Caroline Lucas and Neil Lawson somewhere in this room. And I share your reactions. But here's the thing. Had we snuck that win, suppose we got 51%, that wouldn't have changed what's happening somewhere down there at ground level. Great swathes of Labour's working class votes would have still voted out. And if Remain had won, there'd have been lots of Labour Party politicians now making boilerplate speeches about these people, you know, the kind of thing, we have to reconnect with them. We need to listen, blah, 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 blah. And absolutely nothing would have happened. We might have got some working group that would have reported to the leader's office, you know, the kind of thing, a couple of paragraphs on page 8 of The Guardian. But now I think we really have to take notice. As someone once said, this shit, as they say, just got real. And because we aren't there for these people, someone else was. And those someones included UKIP, Rupert Murdoch, and God help us, Boris Johnson and Michael Gove. And UKIP is a party with access to big money. And they can get in there and go after this vote. And if they succeed, all our hopes as British progressives come to an end. We are now forced, absolutely forced, to acknowledge just how divided our society is, and that we failed to show a path that resonated in the hearts of our people. So where do we go now? As I said, I don't mean literally right now in terms of the tragic rift in the Parliamentary Labour Party. I mean, where do we as a movement go? I know this is the time for hard, practical thinking, but it seems to me crucial that we rediscover a vision. When I think about the parties that are riding waves of support right now, they all have one, even UKIP. Their vision might not be ours, but by God, they've got one. There was something laughable about UKIP until very recently. Leave the EU, don't be silly. Now, here we are. There was something laughable about the SNP activists doorstepping a Glasgow council estate 20 years ago. Scottish independence, don't be silly. But here we are, and it looks more likely with each year that passes. And that flame of hope and belief that kept the party plodding steadily forward through years of defeats and irrelevance was never put out. It was kept alight. Maybe there isn't something so very laughable about Clyde Cymru's dream of an independent Wales now. Who knows what's happening deep in Welsh hearts? One thing is for sure. Clyde Cymru are never going to sweep to victory by the latest feedback from targeted focus groups in key marginals. It has been a vision that has kept them alive, and if they ever win power, it'll be that same vision that takes them there. What is it that keeps people trudging around the houses, delivering leaflets, or turning out on a drizzly Tuesday night in November to yet another meeting? I am sure many of you have been there. What was it that fueled the founders of the Labour Party through its 40-year slog to government? A slog that took in two world wars, the worst recession ever seen, the rise of Nazism and Soviet communism. It was a vision. Yes, there were the nuts and bolts, the crucial practical issues that they could build coalitions around. The hospitals for the sick, the pensions for the elderly, the schools for the young, decent homes for everyone. But it was always more than that. It was giving to ordinary working people a sense of self-respect, a sense of pride, a sense that they and their families and their children were worthy of the same honour as that which was due to the rich and the wealthy and the powerful. That without their full participation, their full acknowledgement, Britain was not Britain. What happened to the passion that built such a vision? How do we find a new one? One thing I know for sure is that a technocratic, managerialist, focus group-led party will not find one. One practical way is to stop with all the bogus listening and actually give people the power to speak. It's pretty simple. It's called proportional representation. Actually, there's a better word for it. It's called democracy. And that's something I, like most of you in this room, really believe in. It's one of the great defences of real progress, and we should never be on the wrong side of it. It's one of the reasons why I won't sign up to attempt for Parliament to overthrow the referendum result. That would be utterly wrong. It would speak of complete contempt for the people. But neither do I believe a bunch of politicians in a back room should now be able to negotiate Brexit on our behalf without the democratic consent of the British people. And if that's a deal that they can't stomach, then we must have the option of remaining in the European Union. So as a starting point, if we rally around the cause of democracy, that very deepest of British political ideals, this country that produced the mother of parliaments, we can begin to build an alliance out of the many strands of the progressive left in this country. Because let's remember, in May 2015, the Tories got just 1 in 4 votes of registered voters. And if you allow for the millions of eligible but unregistered, they got just 1 in 5. This is no unstoppable juggernaut. We really have nothing to fear from them. That then is our starting point. What comes after that? Who knows? It's for the British people to tell us. But I, for one, am ready to find out. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Clive. So we're going to continue with Tommy. Are you? Yep. We'll continue with Tommy Shepherd from the SNP.
Thank you very much, and greetings from Scotland. I want to try and give you a view and an impression of where we stand after what's just happened, and hope that it may inform the discussions and the decisions that you take here. But just to try and recap and where we've got to in Scotland over the last few years, because it has been a time of really quite momentous political change, with more things happening in a few years than had happened in the previous 30 years. And in particular, it has been a time of political realignment. And we now have a situation, I believe, where the two great radical traditions that have created and been part of and driven Scottish history, that on the one hand of the desire for national autonomy, and on the other, the desire for social and economic justice. Those two traditions are more or less fused in a new contemporary political hybrid, which is a progressive force that commands the majority support of the population. And the reason why that has come about, in my belief, is all to do with the process of the independence referendum that happened in the period 2011 to 2014. And because of that, two things had to happen. Those who wanted an independent Scotland had to answer the question, what sort of country would this be? Who would be in charge? Who would control it? How would this thing run? How would that thing run? And in answering those questions, they, to a man and women, came forward with answers that says, we want Scotland to be more equal, to be more tolerant, to be more outward looking, to be more inclusive, to be fairer than the country that we live in today. And so for them, independence was presented in the Yes campaign of 2011-14 as a means to achieve social and economic change. And likewise, those from the labour movement tradition, the socialist tradition, who had long thought during the most of the 20th century that this constitutional debate was a distraction, was a diversion from class politics, they began to realise that independence, rather than being a distraction from social justice, could be the midwife that would achieve and deliver the things that they had longed for all of their lives. And so these traditions came together in a powerful Yes campaign that dominated Scottish politics in that time, and which did not win the referendum, but because of the process and because of the inclusive and positive way that it was organised, it left an incredibly powerful legacy. And I am one of the beneficiaries of that legacy, if beneficiary be the word. I joined the SNP 3 days after the referendum campaign failed, along with about 80,000 other people. To put that in perspective, that would be, in a UK sense, that would be a political party with more than 1.2 million members. That is the surge that has happened to the Scottish National Party. And we achieved a situation by May 2015, we won 56 out of the 59 Westminster seats in that general election. And what has happened is that the entire politics of Scotland have been realigned in communities, streets, whole towns that once used to be solid Labour supporting areas have now put their trust in the Scottish National Party. And I say that not in any sectarian way, but simply to point out that I think what has happened in Scotland, which is different than the situation in England and in Northern England in particular, is that as Labour drifted away from its traditional working class support, the electorate in Scotland had an alternative ready-made and ready to step into the gap. And in many ways what has happened is that the principal Social Democratic Party of Scotland has been replaced, and it is now the SNP rather than the Labour Party. And it was that party in government and in the community that fought the EU referendum campaign that we have just had. And I have to say I'm dismayed at this most miserable of referendum campaigns that we have had throughout the country. I thought it was uninspiring and uninspired. It plumbed new depths in terms of the political discourse of this country, and it was fought in so many communities, not as a referendum on the EU, but in a referendum on immigration and on immigrants. And it has left a situation now of poison in many of our communities. But let us not kid ourselves that that's something that happened in 3 or 6 months. That is a phenomenon that has been decades in the making. And now, at least, as Clive said, if this is a wake-up call to do something about it, I am glad about that. We have a situation now in Scotland where we tried to run a positive campaign, although having been, frankly, battle-fatigued, it was very difficult to do so. But we did run a positive campaign. We stressed the social benefits, the international benefits, the benefits of migration. We talked about that in Scotland because, God, we desperately need people to come and live in our country. So we ran a positive campaign about being a positive European nation, and we won the referendum. We actually won with a surprisingly large turnout and result, because for many people in Scotland, they thought this wasn't really their referendum, to be honest. This was essentially a referendum that only happened to satisfy an argument on the right of English politics. And many people felt resentful about it, but they turned out and they voted for the EU in a positive way. So we now have a situation in Scotland where people voted in 2014 to remain part of the United Kingdom, specifically on the promise that by doing that, they would remain part of the European Union. And then they voted in 2016 to remain in the European Union, only to find the majority of the United Kingdom saying that they wished to leave. Now, on the face of it, those two aspirations of people to stay in the United Kingdom and to stay in the European Union cannot both be met at this time. And what the Scottish Government is now engaged in doing is in trying to see if there is any way in which that circle can be squared, to see if there is a relationship that can be established, as yet unknown, that would allow people in Scotland to keep their European passports while people elsewhere in the UK might lose theirs. There has been talk of a reverse Greenland situation, for those of you that study constitutional politics, whereby Scotland might take over the UK's role as being a member of the European Union while most of the UK left. But in order to do that, of course, that would require the Scottish Parliament to have additional competences and powers that it doesn't have at the moment. So most of all, that would require political will, not just in Scotland, but in Westminster and in Brussels, to allow these special arrangements to evolve over the next few months and perhaps the next year. Now, I do not know at this stage whether that is going to be possible, but I want you to be very clear that what we are engaged in is a genuine exercise to see if it is possible to find some way for the aspirations of the people of Scotland to be delivered, and that is to stay within the European Union. If it is not, if all possible avenues to achieve that have been tried and are exhausted, then it is the case that we may only have one way to achieve that end, and that is to ask people to reconsider the vote they took in 2014 and to vote yet again on the proposition that Scotland should become an independent country. And as Nicola Sturgeon has said, that option is now very much... Okay, that option is very much now back on the table. And I just wanted to, in my 30 seconds, say this. We are trying to look after the people who voted for us. We are trying to see if we can carve a way for a new Scotland in this 21st century. But very much, that is not a means to keep us separate. That is a means to allow us to participate more in Britain, in Europe, and in the world. And you will find us in Scotland great friends and allies, I hope, when it comes to talking about a progressive alliance and achieving constitutional change throughout all of these islands. And I hope that actually one day you will see that the campaign for Scottish independence will deliver such a constitutional shake-up that it will be to the benefit of everyone in all parts of the United Kingdom.
Great, thank you very much, Tommy. So now we've heard from some politicians with varying ideas and perspectives, and we're now going to move on and hear from some people who don't work in Westminster or in the Scottish Parliament. So I'm going to welcome Amina Gachinga from Take Back the City to the stage.
This lectern feels really high when you're 5 foot tall. thanks for inviting us down to be at this event. I think that Take Back the City has something really special, and I hope it's valuable to this conversation. The last few weeks have shown how out of touch politicians and parties are with the people, and how powerless people feel in London and across the rest of the country. On Thursday, what we did as Take Back the City was we set up an event outside Stratford Station with a load of pens and huge tablecloths with questions on them like, how do you feel after the EU referendum? How do we build unity and solidarity in our communities? And we spoke to so many people. Some people we spoke to were in tears, and others were just glad to have an opportunity to share their ideas of a vision for a future in London and to not be so isolated as well. So yeah, the people that we were coming across were young, older, white, black, brown, and people of colour told us that they'd voted to leave, because they believed it would help their economic security or housing situations. But now they're afraid of racist and xenophobic attacks, which have increased in the aftermath of the EU referendum, and they feel lied to. This obviously complicates the main narratives being used to explain what happened and shows that more so now than ever before, we need to go out and talk to, but more importantly, listen to people directly. And that's something that Take Back the City is all about. We're really interested in the idea of building a progressive alliance on the left, because obviously the Tories need to go and like UKIP needs to die, whatever. And we need electoral as a party. Just to clear that up. And shows that more so now than ever. And we need electoral reform. But more importantly, this is a time for a rethinking of how politics is being done in this country. But I'm aware that some of you haven't heard of Take Back the City, so I'm just going to talk a bit about us first, before I talk about that stuff as well. Take Back the City started a year and a half ago in response to the lack of democracy we have in London and the outrageous levels of inequality that prevail in this city, the most unequal city in the global north. We saw a huge need for communities in London to have a political voice. And when we talk about taking back the city, we mean something different from Nigel Farage and Michael Gove, yeah? We're talking about taking back the city from the 1% who are creaming off the wealth made by us and also out of touch politicians as well. So last year what we did was we reached out to 70 groups across London. These are migrant workers collectives, tenants associations, students, community groups, grassroots campaigns. And from this, I stood for election with Take Back the City in the London Assembly elections in the City and East constituency on the platform of a people's manifesto, which is based on their demands. And these demands centered on housing, wages, policing, and building people power. And I'm a singing teacher, by the way, so I ain't no politician, but I had to go, do you know what I mean? Democracy should involve way more than talking about policy and what a party thinks is best for the electorate. We've organised a number of political and cultural events where we've had a variety of forms of political expression. Our election campaign was launched in the Astor Community Hub in the Royal Docks in Newham, where I've got a little choir there that I work with every Monday, and our People's Manifesto was at the Osmani Centre in Whitechapel, and both events were a hub of participatory politics, spoken word, music performances, and they were a world away from regular party conferences, which are usually held in really dull corporate spaces. We canvassed on the streets, and we took to the tops of double-decker buses across East London, where we performed a poem written by Take Back the City organiser Rowan Iandy Smith and myself, and it's called Can You See Us Now? And I'm just going to give you a few lines of this poem. While you regenerate this city, it seems you've forgotten who generates this city. We are two generations and more of builders who have made this place a home, who have made this place our own. So that was just a little bit of what we did on the buses. Now this might seem like a really strange way of approaching people as part of an electoral campaign, but it actually really brought people to life. And like, I remember students at the back of the bus, and some of them recognised me, which is like really a bit weird. But they were like, yes, get in, you know. People were listening, they were actively engaging, and it opened up debates and spaces where we're not feeling free and safe to talk about our politics. I think that's really important. So through all of this activity, some people have become politically active, either through organising with us or by voting for us, when in some cases they had never organised or voted before. And we managed to achieve 1,368 votes in May, which is not a lot in the big scale of things, in a 500,000 like person constituency, but it shows that a small group of people with almost no resources can enter politics and we can make an impact. Politics. like, what I'm saying is that politics is often pitted as this thing that some people know how to do and most people don't. And our experience show that everyone has a view on the issues they're facing. And we even, if we ask ourselves, we have a vision of how to move through these issues, but we often lack a political platform, an exciting one at that, because there are plenty of dry ones, but we want an exciting one, from which they can express these views and these visions. So why does this all matter now, and what relevance does it have to building a progressive alliance? Well, it matters because it would be a mistake to think we just needed to get rid of the Tories. The forms of political organisation that we have at the moment are inadequate, and they fail to engage with the vast majority of people in London and the rest of the country. Obviously, we would prefer a left-leaning progressive alliance to a Tory government, or UKIP, oh my gosh. But this isn't about left-leaning political parties working together. It isn't going to be progressive if parties don't change the way they do politics and make it more open to young people, people of colour, women, working class people, migrants, refugees, people who lack a political voice but make our city and our country what it is. The last thing I want to say is, what we're asking for is parties to welcome the challenge of becoming more transparent, accountable and democratic, and to actively engage people in more creative ways. Step outside your comfort zone, it's going to be fun. And to prioritise the voices of marginalised communities, because they ain't being heard. Only through taking this leap will people in London and across the UK have faith in a political system that values their contribution and in which they have real power. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amina. And I get the irony of us sitting in quite a posh, sort of stale political environment right now, but we're working on it. So lastly, I'd like to invite John Harris to the stage. He's a journalist and does a brilliant documentary called Anywhere But Westminster, which I'm sure he'll tell you a bit more about.
Thank you. I am a journalist. I also write a column for The Guardian once every 2 weeks. I haven't really got enough to say to write one once a week. But I'm not a columnist. I think we've probably got too many columnists in this country and we've not got enough journalists. We certainly haven't got enough reporters. And that's what I do. We make a series called Anywhere But Westminster, myself and my colleague, John Domokos, where we report. We go out into Britain. Sometimes when we talk to other people in the media, they treat us like we're war correspondents. Which may say something about exactly how we got into this mess. I'm going to tell you about a few of the places that we've been in the last 5 or 6 weeks, but also the last 6 years. In the context of what's happened, and the forces that led us to this point, the social, the political forces, the economic forces. About 2 years ago, in 2014, around the time of the Scottish referendum, John and I made a film partly set in a place called Penygraig, in the Rhondda Valley in South Wales. It's a place where my family's from, so I know it, and it's a place missing what I used to associate with it when I was 6 or 7 years old, coal mining. Nothing has really come along to replace coal mining, nothing at all, really, in that place. So it feels like it has an emptiness, really, at its heart. It's the sort of place we'd still call a Labour heartland, and it still has lots of heart. But its affinity with the Labour Party, you only had to walk around and talk to people to know, had waned. Most of the people we met in Penygraig and the Rhondda Valley, who still voted Labour, said they only really voted Labour because it's what their dad or their mum or their grandma or their granddad used to do. And once you got much beyond about the age of 35, you met lots of people who didn't vote at all and who had no idea of what the Labour Party was meant to stand for. And in the middle of the village of Penygraig, there was a big sort of monument to all this, a huge Labour club. Vast Labour club. God knows what goes on in there. It looked like it fit Glastonbury in it. And it hadn't had a lick of paint, obviously, in 30 or 40 years, and we were told it had only relatively recently decided to let women in. Straight up. Now, when we put this film, partly about Penygraig, online in the Anywhere But Westminster series, in which people said they didn't really know what the Labour Party was about anymore, the local MP went mad. He went on Twitter and he accused us of lazy journalism, which I never like, for some reason. And he said that when Labour was in power in Westminster, his constituency had had new schools, two new relief roads, whatever they are, and a new hospital. Now, obviously they're good, you know, they're even great things. But I thought at the time, do they represent any change to the fundamental condition of places like Penygraig? Do they represent any kind of shift back to the relatively vibrant, confident places that they were 60 or 70 years ago? Do they materially affect these awful imbalances that we have in this country? Of course they don't. It's not about living. Even with all that public spending, it was more about survival. Now we fast forward to what happened 2 weeks ago. In Rhondda Cynon Taf, the local government area that includes Penygraig, 54% of the vote was for Leave. I'll rattle through some other places. In Stoke-on-Trent, a place where John and I spent a lot of time about 3 weeks ago, some of you will have seen the film, you see the same stories. It's exactly the same kind of plot line, only that story is about the collapse of employment and really a whole culture around the pottery industry. 70% of people in Stoke-on-Trent voted to leave the EU, and just the Scotch and easy stereotypes, a lot of the people that we spoke to were angry and they were white. We also hung around outside Friday prayers at the mosques, and the vast majority of people who spoke to us coming out of Friday prayers said they were voting leave for exactly the same reasons. In Redcar and Cleveland in the northeast, the same story there is about the decline of the chemical and steel industries. 66% of people in Redcar and Cleveland voted leave. There are places not far from here, which those of you who live in London, maybe some of you don't visit enough and you ought to go. I think of the borough of Barking and Dagenham, a place characterised by the end of mass production at the Ford Works, a place which has gone through huge social change in the last 10 or 15 years, where 62.4% of voters there voted leave. There are also stories to be told about differences within places. About 2 weeks ago, John Domikos and I arrived in Manchester, my home city, kind of. I'm from Cheshire, but I always lie and say I'm from Manchester. In the middle of town, around the university, everybody pretty much was voting Remain. When we asked them about the future, they said they were confident about it and they felt good about it. 10 minutes drive to the north of Manchester. You can walk there from the northern quarter where all the hipsters hang out. It's a place called Colliehurst. 6,000 people live in Colliehurst. It hasn't got a kids' playground. The only cash point charges you £1.85 to withdraw money, and the nearest supermarket is a 25-minute bus ride away in Harper Hay. Everybody we spoke to in Colliehurst was voting to leave. These are places characterised by fear. Yes, a fear of immigration and the idea that it might make opportunities even more scarce and wages even lower, and put more pressure on already way overstretched public services. But underlying this all is a very, very cold, frightening really, fear of the future. A fear when you talk to people, even of tomorrow and next week, let alone next year and the year after that. Now, what made all the difference to this referendum result was the choices made by these people and places. They added to those Tory voters who would have voted Leave in any event, and they took Leave over the line. Voiceless places, because of our ridiculous electoral system, to echo something already said, these places have been voiceless for decades, they suddenly had a voice. And just to make one thing clear, something that we found out in the course of all that time on the road, People there, most people there, were not blindly following Boris Johnson or Nigel Farage or, God forbid, Michael Gove. They weren't paying much attention to them at all, because a vast and very justified political disconnection and mistrust and cynicism has long since set in those places. They were making up their minds on the basis of where they lived, conversations they were having with family and friends and so on. And essentially, it seemed to us, they'd had enough of 40 years of neglect, and they took this as a chance to alert the rest of the country to their existence. Now, a lot of people, as far as I can tell on Twitter, which may not be representative, so forgive me, are making the argument that the referendum result, the choice that the people I'm talking about made in large number, should somehow be nullified. This echoes what a couple of speakers have said. To hear some people talk, same Westminster establishment that has so let these people down, which is at the heart of why people voted leave in these places, should somehow contrive to ignore the referendum and keep us in the EU. Or maybe some highly paid London lawyers, I read today, acting on behalf of anonymous clients, might somehow overturn this decision. Now, admittedly, there is something quite strange going on at the moment, given that the people who nominally led the Leave campaign are largely nowhere to be seen. Because they're frit, as Mrs. Thatcher once put it. In addition, a woman I'd never heard of until 3 days ago, Andrea Leadsom, is now tipped to be the next leader of the Conservative Party, and the next Margaret Thatcher to boot. Now, that is because she is affected to be passionately in favour of Brexit. But I read today she wasn't in favour of Brexit about 6 weeks ago. These are weird times. But I want to finish with a few words of warning, if you'll allow me to do that. Please, please, anybody who is minded to do this, and we've all picked this up, notwithstanding the ugly things that we've seen happen, the awful events that have happened in places up and down the country, and the license that has been given to very horrible, malign things, by the way that the Leave campaign conducted itself in this referendum. Notwithstanding all that, please let's not think about the vast majority of people that I've talked about who voted Leave as stupid or deluded or bigoted and hateful. I don't believe... I don't believe that half, 17 million, whatever the number is, of the population is like that. In fact, I think I'm confident enough to say that I know that. If you woke up on Friday morning thinking that the country you live in was suddenly being controlled by a social tribe you didn't know much about, and you suddenly felt terrified about the future, bear in mind that that's how millions of people in this country have lived for decades. Please understand that the Labour Party has left a vacuum in these places, a vacuum which has been growing for 10 or 15 years. And if this referendum is denied, certainly if it's denied when all of this is still raw, UKIP, with or without Nigel Farage, or something even nastier, may well clean up. It'll sweep through these places, and the terrain for meaningful progressive politics in this country will be pretty much destroyed. That's how high the stakes are. He's talking to some newspapers today, incidentally, of a progressive politics which would be all about cities and would leave people in these places to go and vote for somebody else. If you haven't got progressive politics which speak to places which embody the inequality we all fight against, it's not worthy of the name. So to finish, as politics changes at speed in front of our eyes here and all over the world, I hope we, in this room and beyond it, can start to achieve a collective resolution. No question, there are different kinds of Brexit, and the debate on that is vital if we're going to leave the EU, how we do it, who we protect, and so on. But right now, most of our energies should be expended not on that stuff, but on going to places we, and it is we as much as it's anybody else, have forgotten about for far too long, listening to people, and beginning the process of coming up with a politics that finally, belatedly after all this time, addresses their predicament and the awful inequalities that have defined this country for too long. So, let's go out of this stateless country that some people are calling Romania. Let's not hide behind the city walls shouting. Let's go out into the country and reinvent our politics. Thank you.
Great, thanks so much, John. And if you haven't seen Anywhere But Westminster, I really recommend you have a look. They're really brilliant. So finally, our last speaker has arrived. So I would like to welcome Vince Cable to give his 7-odd minutes as a speaker from the Liberal Democrats.
Thank you for your welcome, and I apologise for being late. I was actually speaking at a big meeting on the future of further education, which is a reminder that beyond Brexit and party leadership, there are real things happening out there we've got to try and address. I haven't heard the other speakers, and I apologise if I duplicate what they say. But I just want to address the fact that we've got two overlapping crises. We've got the impact of Brexit, and we've got the fact that at the moment we don't have a coherent opposition. And on Brexit, I completely agree with what John said. The worst possible response now is to disrespect the people who voted to leave. It was actually a very broad coalition. I went round, did probably 20, 25 meetings around the country, and there were, of course, many people in the north of England, people who are angry, people who have had a bad deal from successive governments, reacting against poverty and deprivation. That was an important fact that many of the Remainers hadn't realised. I went round lots of meetings in the home countries with prosperous middle-class pensioners who would come into meetings with the Daily Mail rolled under their arm, and who were obsessed by the problems of what will happen when 80 million Turks come to live in the New Forest. And but it wasn't just that. I mean, I went to Leicester and cities in the north of England where we had big ethnic minorities, and a large number of British Asians were voting for Brexit because they thought that free movement of labour in Europe excluded them. So we're dealing with a wide range of people for a mixture of good and bad reasons. And for that reason, I don't believe that we can now go back and say, sorry, you voted the wrong way, we've got to tear it up. We've got to respect the people, and we've got to respect the conclusion. And there is a comparable set of problems when it comes to dealing with the fragmented opposition. I mean, I was defeated a year ago by a Conservative Party that had a very effective, lethal slogan, which was, you vote Cameron or you get chaos. Well, we've no longer got Cameron, and we've got total chaos. But that is what they voted for. And the tragedy is that if they voted again, they might well win again, despite the appalling political miscalculation of this referendum, despite their attempts in the last year to move Britain solidly to the right, housing policy, trade union reform, and many other issues, because we don't have an effective opposition at present, and that's why we're here. The first issue we've got to face are the consequences of Brexit. And I think all of us in different ways are trying to deal with this emotionally. When you have a defeat, a terrible defeat, or a desertion or death for that matter, you can deal with it in one of two ways. One is mourning and the other is moving on. And I think everybody is at different stages of that spectrum. And, you know, we have to mourn those people who believed in the European ideal, angry and sad, and I totally understood why people wanted to get out on the streets on Saturday. But there's also a moving on and recognising that we're going to face a whole host of challenges in the next few months and years. Immediately, there is the insecurity of the 2+ million Europeans who live in Britain and who are now frightened, many of them, not just frightened of abuse on the streets, but frightened about their future status. I have an East European daughter-in-law, one of many, many others, who for the first time in their life feel insecure here, and that has to be dealt with immediately. But coming down the tracks within months, there is, I think, we can't predict exactly, I think there will be a Brexit recession, and it will be nasty, and it will hit many of those people we've just heard about in the north of England who are already in bad shape. And the instinctive reaction of the next Conservative government, if there is one, will be to deal with this by slashing workers' rights, getting rid of environmental regulation, doing what George Osborne's been talking about the last 2 days, trying to turn us into a kind of Liechtenstein on Thames. And so we have to have a response to that wrong reaction to the Brexit that's coming, and have to think about mobilising public investment, policies that we should have pursued more in coalition. We have to be able to give clarity, security to people who invest here and create jobs through building on the industrial strategy that we had. And we have to make absolutely sure that in the coming months and years, the next parliament or this parliament don't strip out the social and environmental dimensions of Europe, which they will be tempted to do as we gradually unpick the relationships. And if this is going to happen, and if we're going to mobilise against it, we've got to have people working together, which is why we're here. And it will be people, I hope, from my party, from the Greens, from the Labour Party, from Conservatives, some of whom are disgusted by what's happened, and we have to try to bring them together. And I know how difficult it is, because politics is tribal, very, very tribal. I was on the radio a couple of days ago, but with a man who I think is generally accepted on most metrics as being the most right-wing member of the Parliamentary Labour Party. And he just wanted to rehearse the old battles of the last 10 and 20 years against me and my party, as well as his own. And that's the kind of tribalism that we've got to overcome if we're going to make any progress. So I came here because there may be election, I don't know, there may be. But if there isn't, there will be need to face up to the regressive measures that are going to follow in this parliament, and we need to be organised, and we need to cooperate. And that's why I'm here, and that's why those members of my party are here would endorse that platform. So thank you for coming, and I look forward to working with other colleagues in this very, very, very difficult time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vince. It really is great to have people from the Labour Party, from the SNP, from the Liberal Democrats, and from the Green Party here tonight, as well as people from civil society who are making a different way in politics, and people who are actually going out and reporting and listening to people. Now, I realise we've all been sitting listening for a long time now, and we do have some time left, but I'm going to give you a couple of minutes to turn to the person next to you and just have a bit of a chat about all these ideas and thoughts that we've just heard. Reflect a little, talk about whatever you want. If you know the person next to you, make a new friend before we go back to contributions. Hello? Can I ask everyone to quieten down again? Sounded like you were all having very interesting conversations. So we've got half an hour left, and so what we're going to do now is we're going to open up for 10 minutes for contributions from the floor. We're not going to take questions, we just want to hear your thoughts, and because we want to hear as many as we possibly can, I'm going to limit you to 30 seconds per person, so be very, very brief and get your point across very, very quickly. And do note that there will be lots of chances to engage after this event online, and so this is not the only chance that there will be to engage in these conversations, as well as events sort of across the UK. I believe there are people with roaming mics, yeah. Okay, can I, who would like to contribute? And I'm going to just pick some people, because not everyone can. Yeah, there's a woman over here in the front, next to you, Sean.
I'll be as brief as I can. I'm Esther Brudock. I'm the science and technology spokesperson for the Green Party. I have a question, well, not a question, an idea. And my idea we've been living in a bubble here in London. I think that's why it's been a bit of a shock for us. But those who have voted Leave outside of London, it might be worthwhile for us to make links with them, whether it's our opposite council members, our opposite leaders in other parts of the country, so that we can make links with our communities, so that we can understand a little bit better about why they voted the way they did. What is it that they're missing? What is it that we can learn from them? What is it that they can learn from us? Because this whole conversation we're having here is about collaboration. And there are a lot of people out there who don't feel that they've been part of that conversation.
Great, thank you very much. Very hard to see from here. I might need, Ayesha, can you help me maybe choose some people? I can't. Okay. There's a... Okay, great.
Stand up. Hi, yeah, as was apparent in the recent referendum, as you mentioned before, John, about the disdain and the distrust that vast swathes of these Leave heartlands now feel for both the establishment and the political classes, that they're finding sort of a saviour in like the soundbitey headlines of things like The Sun. How can we sort of make this progressive alliance catchier than a headline that's only going to cost you 20p to buy from the local shop?
We got that. Someone at the back, in the back row. Got it.
My concern for any progressive alliance is that it hinges on the leadership of the Labour Party, and it doesn't seem right now that Jeremy Corbyn is particularly interested in any kind of alliance. And to reference Mr. Cable, it seems like he might be forming something much more tribal rather than less tribal. And I'm generally interested to hear from Mr. Lewis whether or not that is the right, if I'm getting the right impression.
Hello. My major concern, I appreciate everything that everyone has said, but really we're looking, what we're saying about a progressive alliance potentially could be a 5-year plan. The people who voted Leave are crying out for urgent action. We've got a Tory government that, who no matter which person gets anointed, is going to do feral capitalism on steroids. So all we're going to have yet again is more of the same alienation. And so my key concern is, what is it that can be done in the short term to try and mitigate the effects of what the Tories, as they seem to remain in power, seem to be wanting to do, for instance, with $150 billion by Carney going to the banks again, rather than going in for something like, you know, people's quantitative easing or green quantitative easing. Now, there has to be something done by all of those parties to mitigate the worst effects of the Tories.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. I'm very optimistic actually about this referendum. We hear all the time, didn't we, for many years, that people don't come out and vote. Actually, we had over 70% of people come out and vote. I think that's a very positive thing. And to be honest, going forward, I'm not concerned whether people voted leave or people voted remain. I'm not sure that's very helpful anymore. I'm concerned, are you anti-racist or are you racist? Are you anti-austerity or are you for keeping the status quo? This is absolutely crucial things we need to be concerned with now. This is why the last speaker talked about what urgent action we can do now. On the 16th of July, the People's Assembly and Stand Up to Racism are organising a demonstration exactly against austerity and exactly against racism and calling for the Tories to go. I hope you'll all come and be a part of that demonstration and show actually whatever side of the debate you voted on, actually we can come together and argue for a better kind of society. Thank you.
Thanks. A lot of the issues John Harrison highlighted exist across Europe. It's very important that we engage with our fellow citizens across Europe and also recognise the rest of the world, because we're still a lot better off than much of the world. And finally, I hope that Caroline Lucas's practical points are followed up.
Thank you. Firstly, I work in conservation, so I have a fairly obvious opinion and direction on most of this. So I've got two points to make. The first is the retainment of like-for-like policy after leaving, or hopefully improvement of policy. And the fact that I don't particularly feel that's been addressed. I mean, I realise things are still early, but I feel there needs to be a good open forum for that. Petitions online by marginal things are not overly progressive. And finally, I live in Brighton, and a friend of mine is a fairly strong Conservative supporter, and a friend of his lives in a fairly strong Conservative seat. So to plant an idea in people's heads, they actually agreed to swap votes. And I think, considering we won't be seeing PR for a while, that might be worth considering.
Hi, I'm Kleina Jordan from Make Votes Matter. We're a campaign for proportional representation. And I want to thank everybody for supporting PR so much in your speeches today. And I fully support a progressive alliance, but I also oppose oppositional politics. And I wonder if we could make this more than just an alliance of the broad left, because our campaign certainly welcomes UKIP supporters, Tory supporters, and I really believe that we have to include everybody to work together if we want to get PR, and I do think we can get it soon, but we do need to work together.
thanks for doing all the running, people with the mics.
I just wanted to ask, given that a lot of what Vince was saying about regressive policies that will come in will probably affect women by and large, why Women's Equality Party aren't here tonight? Were they invited? Hi. I want to say two things. The first thing is that I'm really, really, really happy to see someone from Take Back the City invited alongside people from the Green Party, from Labour, because they're the people that many of us actually see doing the work and speaking to the people that don't get spoken to. So that's the first thing. The second thing is I think that some of what needs to be done now is to really start working. And one of the things that really bothers me now is thinking about all the sort of false terms of engagement that we've been fed throughout the campaigns. One was the vote leave and you're a racist, vote remain and you're not. Some of us know that that's absolutely untrue. The other false term of engagement is that Europe is a friend of migrants somehow, and that's how you see people on Saturday going on a pro-Europe demo and draping themselves in EU flags. When, again, some of us know that the EU is responsible for thousands and thousands and thousands of deaths at the doors of Europe. So I think it's time that we start to do the real work. If we are anti-racist and if we are pro-migrants and if we love migrants, then let's really do the work and let's start having those conversations. Thank you.
Aisha. Two more, and then...
Hello, my name is Felicia. I'm from Organically Community Growers, a market garden up in northeast London. Thank you.
Thank you.
And we are part of, in fact, we helped to start a union called the Land Workers Alliance, and I hope you've all heard of them. Thank you. And I hope you will engage with them when discussing what's going to happen with this huge amount of money we used to pay to the EU that came back here to subsidise really bad farming. Small-scale farmers were not involved in this at all. And the Land Workers Alliance is also a member of the largest union in the world, which is the Via Campesina, which is the union of small-scale farmers and peasant agriculturers around the world, who I think have a huge, huge voice and a huge role to play in saving the planet on a social and an environmental level. So please Great. Engage with us via the Land Workers Alliance. Thank
Great,
you.
Great, thank you. The person directly in front of me, fourth row from the front, has had his hand up for a while.
Thank you very much. Just wanted to say that I'm very much in favour of proportional representation. One of the things that I've noticed is today, and I'm actually a Labour Party member, a Lib Dem voter, SDLP, SDP, etc. But I think what is wrong in trying to have inclusiveness is all the things that have been said about the Conservative Party, where there are a lot of people in Remain, and I think we need to widen the catchment for people there.
Great, thank you. So I have just a couple of contributions from people who have sent in comments via the live stream and would like to share their thoughts with us. So one is that the rise of the right mirrors the failure of the left to articulate any narrative. I'm not sure who sent these in, they're no names. And then that several people on the live stream are tweeting MPs or party leaders asking them to back PA. That's a good thing. We should start with agreement on core values, not get bogged down in policy, says someone else. Communities are under increased attack right now. We need to mobilize the grassroots, work hard in our communities and develop networks of preemptive strategies in dealing with the upsurge in racism. And the last one is to actually achieve a PA, we need centre-left to, they're not in the panel or in the room. I'm not sure if that's true. I mean, they're not in the panel, but maybe in the room. Centre-left.
How about that t-shirt?
Well, there we go. So, for our last 20 minutes, I've got a bit of a tough question for all the panelists to start us off. And so obviously we've had contributions from the floor and from all of you about PA and the need for us to work together and build alliances. But being totally straight, and this has been raised a few times, given the context that we're working in and given the situation at hand, what can we actually do to make that happen? So what can you and your political parties and other people in your political parties do? But also, what can civil society do? And what can we in this room and beyond that do to try and help make this happen? You know, is it something that's realistic that we can actually achieve? Or just something that we're talking about in this room and hoping for? So I'm going to ask all of you to give a response to that. And just take about a minute each to respond to that question. Starting with Caroline. Sorry, Caroline.
Thank you. Well, first of all, thank you so much for so much richness in terms of the different contributions that we've had. What can communities do? I think Progressive Alliance is only going to catch fire and get into people's hearts if it is something that's coming from the bottom up. I mean, I said in my opening words that I don't think this is something that can be cooked up behind closed doors by the party elites, and nor should it be. It can only happen if there is a demand for it from the grassroots, and that's what I hope that we're seeing part of, at least in this room tonight. So it is about those conversations that you might be having with friends and colleagues, wherever you are, in your workplace, in your families, and so on. I mean, it's got to become part of a way of doing politics differently, that we deserve better than the tribal politics that we have to date. And I think that's got to be something that comes from the bottom up. I think the referendum did give us some positive examples of working together. There was a wonderful debate I did actually just up the road on the EU referendum with Andy Burnham and Tim Farron, and it was just so lovely just to feel that on everything that we said that was not just about the referendum but beyond, there really was agreement, and it really made you think, well, why don't we work more closely together? And so there are some things coming up really quickly that I think we could really experiment on to demonstrate that parties can work together in different scenarios. And one of them is something that people have touched on already, the issue of the right of EU nationals to have their status clearly and unequivocally guaranteed right now. There is a... To their credit, Labour have chosen that for their Opposition Day debate tomorrow. Andy Burnham is spearheading it, so I've already suggested to him, I don't know if he's got time to do it, that it doesn't just have his name for the Labour Party on that Opposition Day motion. Why don't we do things a bit differently and have the SNP that agrees with it, have Greens that agree with it, there are some Conservatives that agree with it. You know, let's show on that Opposition Day motion that actually there is a common ground for that. I've got a private members bill to do exactly the same thing that will be debated on July the 20th, and I want to return the favour by getting other people to sign that. So I think what the politicians should be doing is demonstrating in practice now with some of the priorities that are coming up that we can and will work together. And at the same time, I think what you can hopefully all be doing in the different communities and movements that you're part of is hopefully having those same conversations and building the possibility to make this happen.
Thanks very much. Vince, would you like to respond?
Yes, Caroline responded in terms of Parliament. I'm no longer there, so I'm discovering the virtue of Tony Benn's adage that real politics starts outside Parliament. And I think a lot of the things that need to happen are actually community-based, and the fact people standing up for their local minorities when they're under attack, people just meeting like this and trying to think a way forward, that's terribly important. But Parliament's important too, and it means that in the Commons, where SNP, Labour, dissident Tories have a key role in blocking really reactionary legislation in the House of Lords, my party still has large representation and can do the same. So there is a key role for Parliament. But I think the issue at the back of a lot of our minds, and it came through in some of the contributions from the floor, is what does all this mean politically? There may be election in the short run. I think it's unlikely, but it could happen. Do we all do the usual thing and fight each other?
or do we have some kind of understanding beforehand? Very difficult question, it goes against the grain, but we have to face it. And there are things we will all agree on, like the need for PR, other things that are more difficult. But we, I think we now have to face a simple choice, that if we go on as we are, we will get a prolonged period of Conservative government that will move the country further and further away from the kind of things that people in this room believe in. Illiberal injustice will be perpetuated. Or we bury our differences, which are substantial, and we try to find a way of working together, not just through rhetoric, but through political cooperation. And I think that is the big, big challenge that we've got to take away from here.
Great, thank you.
Hi, would you like to go next? I know there were quite a few allusions to the role of the Labour Party.
Yeah, I want to kind of pick up on the point that was made about my own party kind of becoming less plural. I think what we have to remember, I think I have to kind of disagree, perhaps potentially with the speaker there, the questioner, which is I do not believe that the situation that Jeremy Corbyn, the Labour Party, finds himself in at the moment is one that he's chosen. And I actually think if you actually think the people who are behind what is happening in the Parliamentary Labour Party, and I'll be quite open here, there have been mistakes made by both sides. If you genuinely think that the people behind what's going on are going to give you a more plural kind of new politics, and I'm afraid you're sadly mistaken. They are very much about the old politics. But nonetheless, you know, look, I'm not Jeremy Corbyn, I'm not John MacDonald, I'm not Angela Eagle, I'm not Owen Smith, I'm Clive Lewis, and I come from a new generation of Labour politicians from the 2015 intake, and we are trying to forge our own way, our own progressive values, our own links outside of the Labour Party with a broader progressive alliance of people. Some people will agree with that, some people won't. But I think I understand, and an increasing number of people in my party, people like Jonathan Reynolds, understand, who comes from a different wing of the party to me, understand that doing business as usual in the Labour Party isn't no longer viable. And I think the key thing here for me on this issue, we've been talking about PR and democracy tonight, and I think there's one key thing about what's happening inside the Labour Party. We can dress it up in terms of arcane democratic electoral college issues that 170 MPs have certain rights. What this comes down to ultimately is that 170 people are trying to hold back the democratic choice of 450,000 members. And the signal, we can wrap it up in technical arguments about who has what right and who has what mandate, but that is how it looks to the public. And I think that is a terrible signal to be sending when we understand with the rise of the authoritarian right, the only shield that we have now is democracy, as someone I know and respect said recently in an article. So how do we begin to connect with people out there? I think I picked up on it in my speech. It was about values and vision. We need a beacon on the horizon that we can all head to, because there will be stumbles. There will be things that we disagree with, but PR may be one of them. But we have to set out a vision for what our society looks like, what we want it to be, how the economy works, and reach out to those people. And that ultimately, I feel, is how we begin to move forwards. And to explain to people, I think people have been politicised by this process of the referendum. It's clear they have. Look at the numbers here tonight. People beyond that. People are talking about politics. People are interested in politics. And I think it's time for us to say, take an interest in politics, or politics will take an interest in you.
Thank you. Tommy, any thoughts on that? So I know the SNP has a different role, but how do you think that we could progress from where we are at the moment?
So your question was, is a progressive alliance possible, or is it a pipe dream, or are we deluding ourselves? Well, yes, it is possible. I have seen it with my own eyes, and the Scottish referendum campaign did involve a progressive alliance, which brought together a very much smaller Scottish National Party together with the Green Party, the Socialist Party, but most importantly, a very, very great number of people who weren't in any political party at all. And it also worked with community organisations, with churches, with trade unions, and it set up, you know, there was Babies for Independence. There was like just a myriad of different groups established. And what was key about it is that they were all focused on talking about, well, what does this mean for me? What does this mean for my life, for my family, for my house, my wage packet, my job, all of the rest of it? And when you can engage people in that way, you will find them receptive to do so. So I have great faith, if you like, in the ability of humanity to try and get out of the mess which we create for ourselves at times. And it can work. And I mean, what is important is that we do this without rancor, and that we try and build bridges between people and always try and search for what we can agree with rather than what we disagree with. And at this point in time in Scotland, for example, the position I outlined earlier of trying to find a way to square the circle between staying in the UK and staying in the EU at the same time, that position was put through the Scottish Parliament with the support of every political party there except the Conservatives. So that's a pretty progressive alliance as well. And key to that is not saying to people, I told you so. Key to that is reaching out to people and saying, look, I know you took that decision a couple of years ago, but what does it mean for you now? What's just happened? Do you want to reconsider that? And allow them to come to that evaluation in their own time. Because if we do that, then the proposition we arrive at will be that much stronger. And just finally on I have to say something on PR, because I do think this is absolutely critical, and certainly while Scotland remains part of the United Kingdom, we want to see, as a matter of some priority, proportional representation introduced in this country. And I say that looking at Caroline, who epitomises the unfairness of the current first-past-the-post system in terms of votes received to members elected, knowing that what happened to the SNP in Scotland epitomised it the other way around. It was ridiculous that we won 95% of the seats with 50% of the votes. That is a corrupt system. And if in order... And if in order to get that changed and get a system where the representation in Parliament equals the votes cast, it means I have to give up my seat tomorrow, I would gladly do so.
Amina, would you like to contribute?
Yeah, sure. Especially Newham. I'm from Newham, I'm from Stratford, and it feels really far away from Westminster, even though it's just on the Jubilee line down the road, whatever. So I feel like politicians are kind of untouchable. You just don't see them around. You see them on the news, and you see, that's just really weird. And I feel like if politicians are really serious about being held to account, then they should be trying to get like big assemblies together of local people and be held to account like once a month or something. I don't know, there could be something in place where people think, oh, actually, when I come here, I can put you on the spot and you're cool with that and you can be real with me. Because at the moment, it doesn't feel like politicians are real with us, right? It just feels like lies and lies and lies are being told. But not only to sort of, you know, hold them to account, but to build a vision for our society that is with them. Because you never really get asked what you want, right? It's kind of like, I was thinking about like community stuff I've done in the past around London City Airport. They're trying to expand it, and I've been involved in a campaign against that. But we actually got in the community centre and we were drawing out plans for if we didn't have this airport here, what could we have instead? Which feels like such a faraway dream, but to allow people to dream is like a really powerful thing, I think, and we need to do more of that. Like the EU referendum was full of despair and no hope and no vision for a different kind of democracy. So yeah, with that, if we did stuff like that, I think people would like be really up for that.
And John,
At a time like this, you should listen to Bob Dylan more often. one of the greatest maxims Bob Dylan ever came up with is in Subterranean Homesick Blues. I think it's the last thing in the song. He says, don't follow leaders. It's a good maxim to live by. Because it begins, in all seriousness, and Bob Dylan is always serious, to answer a lot of these questions. Self-evidently, our electoral system is a sick joke. And it has not just contributed to, I would say it's the single biggest factor in what's got us into this mess. You know, when you go to Merthyr Tydfil, it's not like everyone says, I want the single transferable vote with multi-member constituencies, please. Because they got more brains, right? But what they do say is, no one listens to me. Politicians are all the same. I've stopped voting, really, because it doesn't change anything. You hear that a hell of a lot. So, rather than this great temptation, particularly in Labour politics suffers from this and is still suffering from it now. This idea, and this applies, even though I understand totally why Jeremy Corbyn won that election, I understand completely the awfulness of the agenda of all the other candidates. It was great to hear someone at last talking about austerity and inequality and all of those things that had not been talked about for far too long. But at the same time, you meet some Jeremy Corbyn supporters, and I think they go a little bit heavy on this kind of, the sun shines out of Jeremy's arse 24 hours a day and he's going to absolutely sort it out. It's not fair on him. Similarly, the idea that if we throw Angela Eagle in front of the train, that's going to make things all right as well is even more absurd. But waiting for either of these factions in this bifurcated Labour Party with no real centre in it, you might be waiting until hell freezes over unless you get on with it yourself. So it's brilliant to see meetings like this. We need more of these. We need him in Manchester. We need him in Bristol. We need him in Cardiff and Sheffield. We also need him in Merthyr Tydfil and Stoke and Barking and Dagenham. I'm dead serious about that. And in the first instance, to answer the question that the woman at the back, or the point she raised, about the widest possible alliance of people in the first instance for electoral reform, I think that's right. If you look at great social changes that happened in the 20th century, how we got to 1945, the fact that the Liberal Party came round to the need for greater equality and a greater role for the state was central to that. The fact that some enlightened conservatives, or relatively enlightened, like Quintin Hogg, Lord Hailsham later on, and Harold Macmillan came round to that view was part of what added to that moment. That's how kind of wide you have to think and how you should set your horizons. And in the case of electoral reform, I think we have to think about that. Even to the point, and I'm not sure about this, but it sort of makes sense, that UKIP clearly got 4 million votes at the last election and one MP, not even a member of UKIP, as far as I understand it. There is a clear injustice there. But looking ahead from that, and I don't know about electoral pacts, it always strikes me as talking about that prematurely is too mechanistic, but there might be an election in 6 months, so who knows. But moving on from that question of electoral reform, I don't think it's beyond our collective power to begin to talk about things that unite these various parties and groups and forces on what you might call the centre-left and the left. We all know that inequality in this country is a festering sore, it's gone on for far too long, and it needs to be addressed. And I'm not just talking about the Thomas Piketty 99.1% definition of equality, although that's central to what's happening. There is an inequality in which we all participate, or a lot of us, every day. I speak as one of the sharp-elbowed middle classes, right? We all know what happens. We go out of our way to get the best schools for our kids. Outside the school gate at the weekend, you know, at weekdays we might not talk to that clump of parents from the wrong side of the tracks over there. We've all been complicit to some extent in this sort of inequality. We need to look at ourselves as much as we look at so-called elites.
Thank you, John.
Just quickly. So inequality, public services, every Leave voter, every working class Leave voter I met within 2 minutes mentioned housing and our chronic housing shortage. We have to reinvent the welfare state because work as we know it is really, really dwindling in front of our eyes. There are things we can agree on. Central to that has to be something we haven't talked about in at least 2 or 3 years, and it's insane, which is the urgency of climate change. They're all things we can gather together around. I'll finish. none of this is going to be easy. At Glastonbury last weekend, the great Paul Mason said, look, this is a 10-year crisis. It's going to be hard. Very often, it's going to be shit. But people like us in this room and beyond, we have to do this because no one else will. As some American president or another said, we are the change we've been waiting for. We have to bear that in mind.
Thank you very much, John. So I think we've heard a wealth of ideas and opinions about what can happen next. And I think main things have been about the need for a real economic and political vision for where we go next. And that this vision needs to be built with people from across the UK, from across society, and not just by politicians in a room, that we need to start talking to each other. And I think there's a real challenge that both Amina and John brought for both the grassroots and political parties, that we both have to start talking to each other. And it's up to us to make that happen. We need to put pressure on politicians to really make a progressive alliance work, because without that, they won't do it. And it's really up to us to start building that. And there's been a lot of interest in having these kinds of meetings across the country. And as John said, we need to move out into areas that are not London, that are not the people that we always speak to, and start having those conversations and hearing what other people have to say. And so over the next few months, Compass will be hosting these conversations. And if you are interested in helping to organise, in being involved, then please do. And I am also very aware that these are not all the people we need to be speaking to. We weren't trying to say that this is the Progressive Alliance. We were just starting a conversation and hosting a first stab at what this might look like and how we might get there. So there's a long way to go. Please get involved, stay in touch, like us on Facebook, and email us if you want to help organise. Thanks very much to all our panellists for coming.